It is a shade past the original scheduled start time of 8:45. Hands up if your team is in the Continental Cup Final. Sorry, that doesn't quite work well on a podcast. But anyhow, this is the Cat's Whiskers podcast and we're live. Hello, good evening and welcome. This is the Cat's Whiskers podcast and my name is Tina Taylor. If you would like to get in touch with us tonight while we are recording, then please do so via Twitter. It is the most easily accessible for us to monitor and it's at Cat's Whiskers TV if you didn't already know that. Please let us know. We're especially keen to hear from anybody who's listening, perhaps returning recently from Denmark, or perhaps you're already perhaps you're still en route back home. Let us know, you know, how it was. I mean, you know, we all saw it on various YouTube streams, but tell us how it went. How was it for you? So those of us that were watching from home and those of us around this virtual table this evening, we're going to have a look back on those games and we're also going to have a look at what the Elite League were up to while we were away. So joining me tonight are Joe Balm.
Hello.
Sam Balm.
Hello.
And Adam Reddish.
Good evening.
Right then, chaps. So, let us cast our minds back a little way to Friday. One or two of us around this here virtual table may have had a pint or two since then, but we'll do what we can. We kicked off our Continental Cup campaign against Amiens. Panthers goals, two from Hansen, William Quist, Carl William Quist, if you prefer, and one Sam here. So, Joe, we'll kick off with you. So, I mean, it was a decent performance, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think sort of we didn't quite know what to expect coming in, but obviously with these kind of tournaments, you need to sort of get off going quite quickly. I mean, you only play each team once, so there's not really much margin for error. So you need to start quickly, otherwise, you know, you could find yourself quite easily not qualifying. But I think it was a decent team performance. Amiens certainly had a very aggressive style of play with their forecheck. That meant that we could So if we broke up the players, they were sort of coming at us, that then we could spring attack and often get some, you know, outnumber then on attack. And I think a couple of goals came from that sort of breaking up them sort of coming at us. So yeah, I think we as the game went on, I think to start, we was feeling them a bit out, which I think is to be expected, considering we don't, you know, this is a new team for us. Sort of feeling them out, and then as the game went on, we sort of picked them apart slightly and came away with a 4-2 win. So yeah, I think it was a start to the tournament and something, you know, we desperately needed.
I mean, Adam, you know, we both left work early so as we could get home to watch this game. just a little bit.
There's no bunking.
Yeah. I don't know if you might maybe agree with me. I mean, it sort of seemed a bit of a sluggish start in the first period. Do you think that, you know, the ice surface, the ice pad, you know, had anything to do with it? I mean, it was a bit of a scrappy game from both teams to start off with, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, there was the sort of early exchange of goals, which, you know, got the game off to a frenetic start. But after that, I think it sort of settled down and it was a bit cagey. In terms of the quality of the ice, I'm sure that the players would have had a chance to have trained on it, you know, the day before. I don't quite know when they arrived over in Denmark, but I would imagine that they had a bit of preparation on it, so they would have known what it was like. But it did seem, you know, during that first period that, you know, the ice was a bit choppy. You know, players were making passes and the puck was sort of skipping over the ice a little bit. And but that's to be expected, really. You know, it's new conditions. I know people will say, well, an ice rink's an ice rink. But, you know, having, you know, played a bit of rec hockey in the past, I can tell you that, you know, ice surfaces do differ from rink to rink. So, you know, it does take a little bit of acclimatisation. But, yeah, it was a cagey first period, which, you know, was good for us. I mean, personally, I was hoping that we'd go in at the end of the first period, you know, either ahead or level pegging. And, you know, we went in at 1-1. So that was good, you know. And I think from that point forwards, we steadily grew into the game, you know, got the composure back that we've shown in recent league games. And, you know, from that point forward, I thought there's only really going to be one winner through the second and third periods.
Sam, I'm not deliberately leaving you out. I just know that you only saw the third period of Friday's game, not having the benefit of being able to duck out of work a little bit like myself and Adam did. But I will come to you, I promise. Just, you know, sit tight. We had a bit of enthusiasm going into this tournament based, you know, on the games against Belfast the previous week. And like we've Adam's discussed, a little bit of a shaky start to begin with. But, I mean, for me personally, I think that, you know, Sam Herr really showed his qualities again, didn't he? Sort of, you know, pulled us through a little bit, didn't he?
Yeah, I mean, he hasn't sort of been nicknamed Captain Fantastic for sort of no reason. He's certainly, I think certainly since that speech he gave after the Challenge Cup loss to Manchester, that has sort of, he's certainly galvanised the team and he's sort of leading the charge, as it were, and sort of that aspect. I mean, he was one of the few doing it during our poor start, but he's just carried it on and now he's sort of giving that sort of kick to the rest of the team that they needed. And yeah, he's sort of everything you need in your captain. So not just like the off-ice leadership, but the on-ice sort of leading by example. So yeah, he's definitely valuable in these sort of situations where you're in sort of a unknown sort of territory facing new teams, and he's able to sort of galvanize this team, which is it's almost invaluable, really.
I mean, Adam, just looking at the other end of the ice, if you will, no surprise that Kevin Carr was named the starter for the first game, but after that sort of shaky first period, he made some very key saves, didn't he?
He did. I mean, it was really solid performance. I think, you know, both times he got the start over the course of the tournament, he was really good. And, you know, I think we're starting to see a bit more consistency from him now, which is great. And obviously, you know, playing behind forwards and D that are doing their job really proficiently, that's going to give him confidence as well. So, you know, when he is called upon to make key saves, yeah, he comes up big and makes them. And you know, that's going to give everybody confidence in front of him. So, but yeah, when he was called upon, he didn't let the side down. You know, he's an aggressive netminder. He can sometimes, you know, stray out of his crease a little bit and challenge the shooter. But it seemed to be effective over the course of the weekend. It certainly was against Amiens. And yeah, I'm liking what I'm seeing from Carr. I think you know, he had a wobble, but then, you know, everybody on the roster had a wobble for a few weeks, and hopefully he's pulling out the other side of that now, and we're starting to see some really good performances from him. But can I just mention something about Sam Herr?
Go on.
You know, I think Joe was really good in explaining what he was giving the side, and I think, you know, the word that he used really well to sort of explain what was going on there was galvanised, and it does seem that he's got a very strong aura and presence in the locker room and also, you know, out on the ice, and he really does lead by example. You know, he's such a strong puck carrier. You know, I've taken to watching him quite carefully now on every shift, and it just seems like nobody can get the puck off him. He can have like two or three guys hanging off him, you know, trying to, you know, rob the puck off the end of his stick, but he somehow still manages to find a way. So, you know, that's the sort of thing that other players on the bench watching, you know, will take, you know, heart from and really step up their own game and give that a little bit more. So, you know, long may that continue. And I think he's got the makings and the prospects of being an excellent captain for us.
And Sam, finally, I will come to you. It's a good start. It was a good start to the competition to, you know, see us kick off with a win. What was also nice to see was, you know, was managing that third period. I mean, you know, yes, we conceded a goal, but we also, you know, we'd already gone 4-1 ahead. So, you know, we'd given ourselves that chance to close out the game properly, hadn't we?
Yeah, and I think at times this season, game management has been an issue for us. But, you know, I think when in recent games when we've had the lead, we've controlled it well, and you know, we've not really let them back in. And like, I think particularly against Belfast and this on the Sunday game, for that, you know, it wasn't a high scoring game, but we managed to really control it, and we took that into the game against Amiens.
And one other thing I just want to touch on as well, because you know, we've had discussions in the past, and I think we may have had a discussion about the European style of refereeing that we sometimes have trouble with, but you know, certainly, you know, focusing on the Amiens game for the moment, it was a pretty clean game up until a point, wasn't it? I mean, nobody was taking many penalties, and it wasn't like, you know, there was no, you couldn't have had any complaints until the incident with Adam Deutsch.
I think there was a couple of incidents during the game where there was some questionable hits, no more than like a 2-minute minor, but there were some thing you think, well, is that not a penalty? But there was, again, no call, and I suppose it's a bit more surprising with the sort of the reputation that sort of European hockey has, that it's, they like to crack down on any sort of real physical sort of play, but to see some sort of big questionable hits not get called, I thought it was a bit surprising. But certainly the Deutsch one was, it was late and it was a bit of a hit from behind, so, and also really unnecessary given there was 30 seconds left. And I think that was Amiens taking their frustration out on sort of us, but more specifically Deutsch, which was really unnecessary. But thankfully he was able to come back for the third game. So, you know, not too damaging for us.
No. I mean, Sam, I'll bring you back in because, you know, you've not had a chance to say an awful lot yet. But, I mean, the incident with Deutsch, I mean, if his face doesn't make contact with the Amiens player that he's been kind of pushed into, if you will, you know, maybe he doesn't get injured, and maybe that it's not even a point of discussion. Is that how you see it, or you know, do you see that differently?
Well, I think, you know, there's the potential he could have gone head first into the boards, which would be bad, or, you know, smack his head on the ice. So I think it's just a very reckless and needless thing to go through the back of someone's numbers with 30 seconds to go when you're nowhere near winning the game. But, yeah, I'm very surprised there wasn't any sort of penalty or even a suspension, because it was very late.
Yes, and Adam Deutsch obviously missing the game on Saturday. Unless any of you chaps have got anything else you want to just mention about the Amiens game, we'll pop across to Saturday.
No, move on.
Right, okie dokie. So, Saturday, Panthers faced off against Hungarian side Ferencvárosi, and from henceforth, I'm going to refer to them as the Hungarians, because quite frankly, I don't need to embarrass myself further. Panthers goals coming from Pelini and Hare. Unfortunately, the Hungarians taking the spoils from that one. Adam and myself went to Bunkers Hill. I went to the Bunkers Hill. Adam joined us afterwards. Yes, you had another game entirely to watch. Less said about that, the better.
I went to an equally bad game, yes.
Yeah, yeah, less said about the better. Yep. We'll move on. So, yeah, I went and met Messrs. Balm Sr. and Mr. Bullard and one Mr. Haywood. And we sat in the pub and watched a bit of hockey, drank a lot. So my memories of this particular game are a little bit sketchy, if I'm being honest. I had a great time, by the way, but you know, we all had a lovely afternoon, but I don't remember a lot about the goal, so I'm about the game, so I'm kind of relying on Sam and Joe here to fill in the blanks. But I mean, part of the reason for me personally, I wasn't watching the game, it felt a little bit it wasn't really an entertaining game from a Panthers fan's perspective for me. And I mean, you know, disagree with me if you would like. Joe, I'll bring you in on this one first. But to me, generally throughout the game, it felt like there was a little bit of complacency from the Panthers side, with, you know, the Hungarians being the qualifiers. I think there was a little, you know, there was a touch of, well, you know, we should be all right here.
Yeah, I don't think we sort of clicked as much as we did in sort of the first game against Amiens. Everything just seemed a bit almost disjointed. It just felt like a performance we'd have seen, a month and a half ago, during that our losing streak. So yeah, I think what we said about ice surfaces earlier, I think that played a part, especially with the very small neutral zone. I mean, we've heard Wallace sort of speak about it before our transition, and I think the very small neutral zone really hampered the kind of transitions we generally make on the bigger ice surface. And while we sort of managed it well on the Friday game, I think Saturday, with the way the Hungarians played, I just think that sort of skewed us and messed us up a little bit, and we didn't really have an answer. And then everything was a bit disjointed from then on, and we couldn't really get anything going. I mean, we had quite a bit of possession, but it was just circling. There was no sort of threat to the possession. There was no sort of, we weren't really pressuring them with the possession we have. We weren't sort of at them straight away if we lost the putback. It was all a bit lackluster. It was just a bit of a dreary performance. And then I think Hungary's goals, their goals sort of came at key times. That sort of, I don't know, sort of took the wind out even further. Sort of, sort of like compiled the sort of poor performance even further, and it just really just didn't allow us to get going whatsoever.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the two goals that they scored, sort of in the middle of the second period, that they were, it was all again sort of like, you know, the Panthers of a few weeks ago, where we were conceding in bunches. So I think that sort of served to stick the knife in a little bit, didn't it?
Yeah. The sort of goals that we conceded, we were sort of like, there were sort of rebounds, and then we sort of, our defence sort of switched off, and they were sort of, they had to be sort of on the ball and really hard working for them to get something out of the game. And I think they knew that. And that sort of game plan works, because I think we sort of coasted into that game a bit. I think we thought, oh, this is not an easy game, but we maybe don't have to work as hard as we maybe should, as we did it against Amiens, to get the win. And I sort of think we struggled. We came in at sort of a low gear and then struggled to get out of that gear at any point. And they sort of, their goals came from rebounds, and we were sort of, our defence was sleeping, and they were first to react. And like I said earlier, those sort of goals really sort of deflated us and stopped us getting back into the game.
I mean, Joe touched on it not so long ago, but you know, we had, it felt certainly like we had a lot of possession. And just like, you know, again, a flashback to the Panthers team of, you know, a few weeks ago, we just couldn't seem to build any offence from it.
Yeah, I'm not really 100% sure we are a possession side. I think we are more of a counter-attacking side. So I think if a team's going to sit back on us more, I think we do have at times struggled with what to do. But I think as well, a lot of the time, they didn't really have much of a system, which I think was a bit of a challenge, in terms of there wasn't really anything we could go at. They sort of, I think a lot of time was sort of, they would just try and get around us on the break. So that was quite difficult. And I think with us not really having much of an idea when we had the possession, it really did mean that we struggled to create things offensively.
Mm. And I mean, Adam, you didn't see the game on Saturday, but
no.
when you arrived at Bunkers, and you know, we told you the score and sort of gave you our synopsis of the game. I mean,
yeah.
That it really compounded your day, didn't it? Like, let's be frank, let's be right about this.
Off a wonderful day.
Yeah, but I mean, do you think that there could have been a sense of, oh, here we go, you know, maybe the Belfast weekend, yesterday's results were just a nice little streak that's now going to come to an end, and you know, facing the prospect of having to win against the hosts after losing against the qualifiers, it was probably an uphill battle after that, didn't it?
Yeah, it was all very typical Panthers, wasn't it? You know, maybe beat a team you're not expected to and then lose to a side that you're expected to beat. You know, I was a little bit surprised because I thought we would have took more momentum in from the game on the Friday against Amiens into that, and really sort of lay down a marker to say, right, you know, we mean business this weekend. I mean, obviously, like you said, I didn't see any of the game, so I'm sort of commenting on this blind. I'm only relying on the synopsis and what I've read online about it. But, you know, from listening to those that have seen the game and were able to, you know, explain what went on, I suppose what I think might have happened was there could have been a bit of complacency. You know, we're expected to sweep the Hungarians aside, you know, because they qualified. They might have been seen as an inferior side. Not sure whether we would have had any intelligence on them, or you know, been able to do any scouting about you know, their better players. Yeah, we saw a little bit of their game, didn't we, against the hosts on the Friday evening, and quite frankly, I didn't really think they looked up to much. So if, you know, Wallace was in the rink watching that game, then he might have, well, I don't know. I don't think he would have consciously said to his players, hey, you can go easy, boys, because, you know, you can play in, you know, third gear and still beat this lot 5-0, because, you know, a coach would never say that to his players. But, you know, there might have just been a sense of, well, you know, they got relatively easily beaten on the Friday. So, you know, all we have to do tomorrow is turn up, you know, appear, and, you know, put in a little bit of effort and we should, you know, skate to a routine win. But, you know, sounds a bit cliche, but there are probably no easy games in European Continental Cup groups. So, yeah, there's a bit of egg on the face there, and it's unfortunate that it made our life a lot more difficult for the final game, because, you know, there every chance that we could have gone into that final match on the Sunday having things out of our hands. So, yeah, it was disappointing, really. And as you said, it just compounded a miserable day on the sports front for me.
Yeah, well, you should put, yeah, it's a lesson in choosing your teams carefully, kids.
It is.
Well, as you've now mentioned, Sunday, we'll segue straight into Sunday's game against the hosts. Panthers goals coming from Pellini, Talbot, Deutsch and DeSantis. And quite frankly, Sam, I think that one was the best performance of the weekend. I mean, a little surprising how well we came out, but very welcome, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I think certainly the message that it was pretty much win or bust had certainly been received by the players, and they came out knowing that, yes, you know, I know, you know, taking this to overtime will be enough, but at the end of the day, we need to win to make sure, you know, that winning was the safest way to get through. So I think they certainly came out to win the game, and I think for pretty much all the game, we were the better team.
Very much so. I mean, Joe, we, in a complete sort of reversal to Saturday's game, we actually were creating a lot of offence, and we were a threat, weren't we?
Yeah, I think sort of going forward, we actually looked like we were troubling Galbraith. We were actually giving their defence something to think about, whereas, you know, the night before we never particularly looked like really getting back into the game. But Sunday's game was a complete turnaround. I mean, I think getting that early goal, I think, certainly helped. I mean, I don't, well, you know, we could be talking about a different game had that not happened, but I think that early goal would definitely sort of gave us the confidence to then build on from that and really push on, because like Sam said, it was win or bust, and in a win or bust game, getting that early goal takes sort of that pressure off a little bit and really allows you to play your game and play how you know you can be. And I think that was more of the case on Sunday. We played with a bit more freedom, we were a bit more sort of like going forward, we had more purpose, and it really showed scoring four goals. So, yeah, a great sort of reaction to the previous night's game, and it shows, like Adam said, that sort of we sort of creeping into bad habits. You know, was that Belfast game just sort of a bit lucky? But I think sort of the three games, that Sunday's game was sort of the closest sort of to the performance we saw the weekend before against Belfast. So I think that's a better indication of sort of the performances we should be seeing, you know, going forward in the league. So it was good to see.
I mean, Adam, four goals conceded before the halfway point of the game saw Galbraith being swapped for their backup netminder. And one of the things I did see on social media, there was a little bit of, you know, we can almost forgive Galbraith for that trickler that he let in against Sheffield now. it was a little bit ironic, really, wasn't it?
I don't know, that's still smarts. yeah, I suppose there's a little bit of levelling up of hockey karma, I suppose. But, you know, like Joe said, you know, we just played with great intensity, I thought, on Sunday. You know, we came out the traps really quickly. You know, we forechecked really solidly. well, as solidly as you can, you know, with European officials who, you know, are quite happy to clamp down on everything. But the whole tempo was different. I mean, obviously, like I said, I didn't see that the game against the Hungarians on Saturday, but it sounded, you know, poles apart from that, to be honest, from the sort of level of intensity that the players were showing. And it was great to see, you know, taking the game to the hosts, because before the game, I was quite apprehensive that it was going to be the toughest challenge for us, you know, of the three games over the course of the weekend, you know, going up against the hosts in their own building, you know, with a fairly partisan crowd in the stands cheering for the home side, you know, it was going to be difficult for us. But, you know, we made relatively, you know, light work of it. And, you know, playing well and playing, you know, with you know, real purpose in you know, the offensive zone was really good to see. And you know, I think the hosts looked a bit shell-shocked. You know, that they thought that we might have been the ones that were playing within ourselves, you know, because we're a bit nervous of the atmosphere. But yeah, it just seemed like we went out, we expressed ourselves, we had really good offense, and we just got pucks on Galbraith's net as quickly as we possibly could, and you know, generated some really good chances and scoring chances. And you know, we were really clinical there, because you know, that bunch of goals obviously broke the back of the home side, and they just couldn't respond to that. And even though it was got a bit nervy in the third period, you know, I think was there about 10-11 minutes left when Sonnerjait got their second, and you're thinking, well, you know, another goal here, and you know, it's really going to be a nervy last few minutes in the game. But you know, that game management held firm, and it was good to see us, you know, control things relatively easily from that point forward. And there wasn't really any concern from me that we're ever going to, you know, throw that game away and miss out on qualification from like the middle of the third period. So, yeah, credit to everybody. And, you know, everybody stepped up for that final game. I can't remember whether Talbot was interviewed before the game or in the first interval. You might be able to help me on this, but the way he spoke to the interviewer, you know, like, we are going to win this game. You know, we are going to try hard and we're going to skate really hard. You know, that was, you know, a really, really positive thing to hear, because it just sounded like the players were not going to, you know, leave that ring without having qualified for the Continental Cup final.
Mm. I mean, Sam, Adam's just talked about the goals that we conceded. I mean, you know, we scored our four goals before the halfway point of the game, and when your opposition starts to, you know, gradually chip away, you know, and just sort of claw back that lead, it can get a little bit squeaky bum time, can't it? I mean, you know, you're sort of looking at, you know, the Panthers' ability to manage the game, aren't we? Is he there? Is he gone?
Hello?
Have we lost Sam? Oh, there he is. Oh, hang on. There he is.
He's back.
Yeah, I was saying, you only have to look at when we play Sheffield, our inability to hold a lead and how easily it can be for us to throw it away. But yeah, we held on and we did what was required.
Mm. I mean, you know, do you think we were unlucky to concede those two goals?
Well, I think first one, definitely. I mean, you go down, you're blocking the shots, and it sort of just loops up and over Carr into the back of the net. I mean, there are some goals that sort of go your way and some that don't. I think that was one that sort of didn't go our way, because I think up until that point, we sort of, I don't think there was much chance of them scoring. I think they were sort of getting quite frustrated with the scoreline, but that sort of goal seemed to settle them down a bit more and give them something to chase.
Mm.
But, yeah, no, I think the second goal one was, yeah, again, a bit lucky. I think it just squeaked under Carr, I think, after making the initial save. But I wouldn't say that I'd say they were lucky, but then I wasn't worried about them sort of going on from that and then getting two more. I just thought they were sort of outliers, as it were. They weren't sort of an indication of how the game truly went.
But they were always going to come back, weren't they? And, you know, leave something out there, as it were, and, you know, hard to try and get back into the game. And, I think there's... we took a penalty, didn't we, just after they got back to 4-2. And you're thinking, well, you know, if they can convert on this power play opportunity and make it 4-3, there's still plenty of time left for them to, you know, tie the game up and then maybe even win it in regulation. And that really would have been a bit of pill for us to swallow. But I don't really remember too many sort of clear-cut chances that the Danish team were able to, you know, forge in that last 10 minutes of the game, which, you know, led me to thinking that the D put a good shift in, and, you know, that the forwards back checked, and we just were generally quite solid, you know, with and without the puck. So, yeah, I think that, you know, Wallace got his strategy spot on, you know, during that that final period. And I think hopefully, you know, we continue to see good examples of game management throughout the rest of the season, because it's just an essential skill to have, you know, if you want to compete and you want to be towards the right end of the table rather than, you know, where we've been for the start of the season. Then you know, when you get a lead on a side, you've got to, you know, work damn hard to try and retain it, because there's some teams with some pretty good offense out there these days.
Right, so all of that, stick that into a pot, mix it around, and what you have that comes out the oven is the Nottingham Panthers are in the Continental Cup Final again. Hurrah. We will be meeting Neman Grodno from Belarus, Sondiesk from Denmark, and Krakow from Poland. And my pronunciations are woeful, and I apologise in advance to everybody who is listening to that.
Krakow, that's how it's pronounced.
I know, must try harder. I mean, In Neil Black's interview with Chris Ellis on BBC Sport website, he's already confirmed that Nottingham will not be hosting the final because there is apparently something happening at the arena. Now, I don't see anything on the website. I don't know if somebody can jog my memory and give me some sort of details.
I think it's speed skating.
Ah, there we go. So, it's not listed on most Point Arena's events, but that doesn't mean it's not happening anyway. So yeah, or it's already not going to be in Nottingham. So I suppose there's a genuine chance it could end up in Denmark again. who knows?
Denmark or Poland, I'd have said, was the...
Yeah.
I don't think Belarus. I think generally in these kind of competitions, the IIHF like easily accessible.
Yeah,
locations, and that's why generally the teams from Kazakhstan or Ukraine don't generally get allowed into the CHL if they manage to win the Continental Cup. So one would assume it would be in either Denmark or Poland.
Well, I suppose there'll be a few people checking flights already, seeing what's going on. But that is still, as far as we know, a to be confirmed. So watch this space. I promise I'll try and do a bit of research prior to the next the podcast that we have prior to that one. I'll totally let myself down last week with having absolutely nothing, and I'm going to try and do something about that. We'll see. We'll see what happens. Let's dial it back to the Elite League and see what they've been up to while we've been busy advancing to the Continental Cup final. Wednesday, the clan took on the Devils, and it was a convincing 6-3 win. They've had a mixed weekend with a loss to the Fife Flyers on Saturday and a win to against the Sheffield Steelers at home on Sunday. Sam, clan have sort of stamped their authority on this side of the season so far, haven't they?
Yeah, definitely. I think they've certainly scored a lot of goals, but they've also let a lot of goals in. And I think that's sort of been seen. You know, they've had quite a few high-scoring games, and they do seem to be sort of win heavily one game, lose quite heavily the next. So I think they're consistently inconsistent, I'd say.
but top of the table, you know. So it sort of feels like they're going for the Pittsburgh Penguins strategy of, oh, well, we'll just score more than you. That just seems to be where they're going with at the moment. Couple of other kind of surprise results, I suppose. I mean, after a double loss to the Panthers last weekend, the Belfast Giants are on a bit of a losing skid, which I'll jump forward a little bit. They've made some changes today, as good teams do when they're not doing so well. They have brought in David Goodwin and also released Jean Dupuy and what's the other guy's name? Jesse Forsberg. Sorry, I knew it was Forsberg, but you know, I thought I'd do him the dignity of his first name, seeing as I went with everybody else's. Adam, it's not really a surprise, is it, given the way the results have been for them the last couple of weeks?
No, they've been on a bit of a horrible run of late, haven't they? And you can sort of see the frustration, really, in Adam Keefe when he comes out to give his post-match interviews. You know, he seems to be cutting a bit of a frustrated figure at the moment. You can imagine that he's been probably working hard behind the scenes to try and secure, you know, new imports that will help them out of the rut that they're in. I think, you know, offence has been a big problem for them. They just don't seem to be scoring goals, which is strange because, you know, you looked at the roster before the season started and you thought, well, you know, that, those forward lines have got, you know, plenty of goals in them, probably enough goals to be certainly challenging at the very top of the table. But, you know, things have gone really quiet of late on the goal scoring front. So, you know, Keith's sending a message. You know, he's sent two players away, released two, and you know, he's bringing somebody in. So, yeah, roster changes there, and it'll be interesting to see how that all impacts on their level of performance. Because, you know, with the greatest respect to Dundee, you wouldn't expect them to, you know, go into Belfast's building and skate away with a win. I mean, I think Belfast scored in the last second, didn't they, to make it 4-2. So, you know, it was a 4-1 game, really, in essence. I think we all know that Adam Keefe is, you know, mega competitive and, you know, loves to win. So I suspect he'll be hurting quite badly at the moment, and he'll be, you know, desperate to try and do something to arrest the slide that they've been on in the last few weeks.
Right. We'll just wrap up with one final bit of news, and quite frankly, this is massive. Anybody who says it's not, you're wrong. It's fantastic for, you know, anybody who's in the general vicinity of Nottingham. Apologies to those of you who are a little bit further afield, but, you know, we are genuinely quite excited about it. Just, you know, generally speaking, there's been a few negative Nancys, but frankly, I'm not listening to them because Team GB are going to be playing Team Canada in a warm-up game at the Motorpoint Arena, Nottingham. Hands up who's got their ticket. Oh, sorry. Yes, that doesn't work on a podcast. but I have my hand up. I have a ticket. I'm going. It's happening. I mean, it's brilliant, isn't it? So, Sam, what's not to like about it?
Nothing, really. I mean, it may only be a friendly, but I think for a lot of people, it's probably one of the only chances they'll get to see these players in the flesh. You know, it's a big name coming into town, and with it being, you know, just before the start of the World Championships, it's a good opportunity for us to measure ourselves against them.
I mean, you know, this is the, you know, year two of us mixing it with the big boys, Joe. And, you know, surely we can only continue to progress. You know, we have to be able to build on what the foundations that we've laid already, haven't we? And this is a great way to do it, surely.
Yeah, I mean, sort of, you want to be challenging yourself against the best, because you are going to be playing the best. I mean, no offence to like our previous opponents, like Poland, who have played in the previous years, but they aren't particularly going to get as prepared for facing the likes of, you know, Sweden, USA, Canada in the games that truly matter. So we needed to take this step up and really show that we are serious about, you know, staying up again. And I didn't quite expect, I expected us to maybe go for a higher caliber opponent for these warm-up games than previous years, but I didn't quite expect us to go this big. But full credit to everybody who's involved in making this event happening and getting it on, because it's a win-win for all round, really. I mean, I'm sure, and I know that the NHL do these like the global series, and while they quite haven't got to the UK yet, I reckon they might be sort of, you know, doing a bit of publicity with the Canadian team to sort of like sort of build the game over here as well, because there is certainly a market to sort of push the NHL game over here. So I think, yeah, it's a win-win for everybody. I mean, like Sam said, we'll be seeing some of the best, and this maybe will be sort of the only chance some people get to see these people in the flesh, and that's not an opportunity I would want to pass up on. So I've got my ticket as well.
I mean, Adam, the way the Islanders are playing at the moment, they're obviously still going to be a bit busy with Stanley Cup and all the rest of it. So, but you know, surely there's going to be some players in that roster you're going to look forward to seeing, you know, whoever your NHL team is, aren't they?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's going to be quality, whatever roster Team Canada put out. You know, you're always going to have a mega, mega competitive and ultra talented team, aren't you? So, you know, depending on which teams get dumped out of the Stanley Cup early doors, or those that don't even make it, you know, you can expect maybe a couple of the bigger sides might not make it every year. So there'll be all the household favourites, I guess, and you know, it will just be a supremely talented and quality roster that that appears in Nottingham next year. So it's, you know, kudos to everybody involved for making it happen, really. You know, it's a real sort of sign of intent, I think, from the governing body that they're able to attract, you know, Team Canada to come and play a very prestigious home league. You know, so you know, round of applause to everybody, really, for making that happen.
Right then, chaps. I think we've sort of covered everything that we intended to cover, unless anybody else has got anything they want to throw into the pile. Silence is golden, apparently. Right, okie dokie. So, I think we'll call it a night at that, then. All that remains for me to say is thank you very much to you guys who have listened to us live. Thank you very much if you are listening after the fact, and thank you very much for your continued support. Thank you very much to my co-hosts this evening. We have Joe Balm.
Goodbye.
Sam Balm.
Goodbye.
And Adam Reddish.
Good night, all.
We'll see you again next week. I'm sure we'll have some Elite League games or other to talk about when we've come back down to earth. Ta-ra!